This conference will now be recorded.
Hello everyone, am I audible? Yes, thank you, Kia. So today we are going to have a free session. So we at RAISE MRCOG Part 2, I welcome you all. I'm Dr. Rashmi Patil, Director and the Chief Mentor for the RAISE Academy. So this is me here, and RAISE Academy is my dream venture. We have an excellent group of mentors here, Dr. Geetika, then Dr. Siddesh, Dr. Achisman, he's a biostatistician, and Dr. Rupali. So she is from the NHS system and she covers the clinical governance and the teaching and ethics from in the part two and even for the part three sessions. So let's start the journey about what the new GTG says about. Now, amniocentesis and chorionic villus sampling, this was introduced recently in October 2021. It states that the pregnant women are offered amniocentesis or chorionic villus sampling for the prenatal diagnosis. It's given for a variety of reasons, especially when you suspect that there is a higher chance for the aneuploidy screening results, the fetus has some structural anomaly, and there is a known or a risk which is already existing, that is an inherited genetic condition. Now, implementation of this, the National Combined Aneuploidy Screening, and increased use of the cell-free fetal DNA. This means NIPT. It is a non-invasive prenatal testing where the baby's freely floating genetic material, these cell-free fetal DNA, are taken from the maternal blood samples. This is almost 99% sensitive. And then along with the combined aneuploidy screening and the NIPT, this has brought down significantly the invasive test, such as the chorionic villus and the amniocentesis. But having said that, the CVS and the amniocentesis, they remain the only definitive diagnostic test for the aneuploidy in the pregnancy because they are 100% confirmatory. Now, when do we perform? So all these are important exam questions. So remember, you should know that CVS can be performed between 11 plus 0 to 13 plus 6 week gestation. This is the preferred one, okay? So a lot of things the RCOG deals with can be extended, or the preferred one, the best. So you should know that this is the preferred one, 11 plus 0. It's not 11 plus 1 also. It is 11 plus 0 to 13 plus 6 weeks of gestation. The chorionic villus sampling is usually performed. Remember these words. If required, the chorionic villus sampling, this can be performed between 14 plus 0 to 14 plus 6. So here, what did we do? We extended another week. Okay. So it can be performed. Usually is 11 to 13 plus 6. It can be performed to 14 plus 6 week gestation. What about amniocentesis? The guideline says that this is performed to obtain the amniotic fluid analysis, and from 15 weeks onwards, this can be performed. There is a little difference between this current guideline and the older one, so I'll be highlighting that in the end. So the new guideline says it can be performed to obtain the amniotic fluid analysis and usually offered from 15 plus 0 weeks. Okay. Now, informed written consent is a must. So whenever we do some intervention, it is not the verbal consent. The intervention requires an informed written consent. So take an informed written consent from the mother prior to the procedure. And the women, they should receive an information on the aftercare, that what they're going to do later. For example, if it's a negative mother, Rh negative, then the need for the prophylactic anti-D in the non-sensitized Rh negative women, it is given, and indications to seek any medical advice following the procedure. They may have some pain or bleeding or any such stimulation. So you have to seek the medical advice. Now, what additional risk factors it can be associated with? So this is very important. This has been changed recently. So initially they were telling about 1%. So women should be informed that additional risk of pregnancy loss following transabdominal CVS, which is performed by an appropriately trained operator, this is likely to be below 0.5%. This is very important. Initially, they were considering at least up to 1%, but now it has come down. The woman should be informed that additional risk. This is nothing but it's not an age-related risk or something. That is different. What additional risk is this procedure going to show? So, additional risk of pregnancy loss following amniocentesis. This performed by an appropriately trained operator. This is also below 0.5%. Okay, so easy to remember. These words are highly important because the trainer should be appropriately trained. The operator who is doing that, he should be appropriately trained for this procedure. And then it shows that it is going to bring down the procedure-related additional risk of a miscarriage to less than 0.5%. Sometimes the amniotic fluid may appear cloudy or purulent, or there can be some clinical features of infection also. So you may have to give an antibiotic. But here in that condition, the maternal sepsis is rare, but potentially a serious complication of the amniocentesis and the CVS. This is also we are supposed to know. Now, what the recent updates say? So recently upgraded Cochrane review for these two procedures, it reported a low quality randomized evidence comparing the transabdominal and transvaginal CVS. So it has compared the route by which you do the CVS. Now the procedure related pregnancy loss was 1.4% for the transcervical CVS in that study, and transabdominal CVS was 1%. This is about this particular study, what they have observed, this Cochrane review. But overall, when you see, when it is done by the expert here, this should be informed that it is below 0.5% when it is done by the appropriate trained expert. However, risk of pregnancy loss after transcervical CVS was only 0.27%. These are the separate instruments which they use to take a sample. Some forceps are used, some cannulas are used. So when the forceps was used, it was less, and 3.1% when the cannula was being used. So it shows that forceps may offer some advantage over this. So these are the type of instruments what you're doing. Now, procedure-related risk may be increased when the procedure performed by the less skilled operator. Yes, this is self-explanatory. And there is inverse association between the experience that they have and the pregnancy losses. There is no evidence to specify the optimum number of procedures for a trained operator to maintain their skills. So they have to maintain this one. It is advised that the appropriately trained operator completes or the supervises at least 20 procedures annually. So this is what it is required. Now, what does this table say about? Whenever you're doing the risk which are associated with these two procedures, so whenever you're doing this procedure, you may require a second sample, or you may have to repeat a procedure up to how many percent? Up to 6% in both the procedures. Okay, this is same. Now, when we are doing chorionic villus sampling, we are bothered only about the chorionic villus sample, the placental bit, what we are expecting, right? But when we do amniocentesis, we are taking the fluid. Sometimes this may get contaminated with the blood. That's why they have written here it is not applicable. When we are doing CVS, the blood stain sample is not applicable because we are entering into the tissue. Here we are taking the fluid, right? That's why the blood stain sample, it becomes important here. 0.8% is the blood stain sample, the risk which is associated. Okay, so the remaining ones are not that excuse me, important. About this second sampling repeat procedure, this you may remember as 6%. The blood stain sample you can remember as 0.8%. Now the maternal cell contamination can happen 1 to 2%. Rapid test failure could be there 2%. Then again, severe infections, the fetal injury, and the maternal visceral injury, these are very rare occurrences. Now, women should be aware that the results of the CVS can be affected by a confined placental mosaicism in 1 to 2%. There could be some genetic variations in the placenta itself. It is called a mosaic placenta. So that happens rarely. It is 1 to 2% only. Now, if there is a fetal structural anomaly, what we should do? You move forward with the discussions regarding ongoing care and including the option of termination of the pregnancy if the woman or the couple they wish to consider this. So you can have this discussion. Now, if there is no structural anomalies, then the PCR results, what you're obtaining following the CVS, it suggests that there is a chromosomal anomaly. A full karyotyping should be awaited before you take any decision. Whenever there is no gross anomaly, you just wait for the full karyotyping and then take the decision. Now, additional risk of invasive testing could be a severe maternal sepsis, but this is a very rare complication. Speaking about amniocentesis, this should be performed after 15 weeks of gestation. Remember this point because there are certain changes. So amniocentesis should be performed after 15 weeks of gestation. Before 15 weeks, owing to higher risk of pregnancy loss and the potential of talipes equinovarus, this is really important that you should know why this particular thing, what are the procedure related typical complication that could have. So amniocentesis, it is going to be talipoequinovarus. Now you can just remember a scenario. The baby is there and the fluid around the baby. If you take out some fluid, the compartment, it may get collapsed. Just remember, the feet may get collapsed or the feet may get inward turned because baby has to sit in that compacted chamber. Imagine like that. So the feet gets inward, the intern can happen. So this is a talipoequinovarus kind of a situation, right? So remember that amniocentesis, you're taking out the fluid. So that can be associated with talipoequinovarus. Early amniocentesis is also, this has resulted in an increase in 3% in requirement for multiple needle insertion. So whenever you're doing less than 15 weeks, there was not only a complication, higher risk, but also multiple needle insertions may be required. Now, early amniocentesis, this has cytogenetic implications. Like for example, with increased risk of failed culture, you are not getting a good cells over there to grow. So that could be 1.8% compared to 0.2% with the mid-trimester amniocentesis. So when you're doing it in an early phase, the failure rates are more. And therefore, you're not getting a good cell. So the false negative reassurance can come. So this we should remember. That's why, because of all these reasons, amniocentesis should be performed after 15 weeks of gestation. Now, individual laboratories, these have reported increased risk of obtaining low quantities of the DNA from direct extraction when the amniocentesis is performed before 16 weeks also. They had some discrepancies there, but the guideline tells us about after 15 weeks, you are supposed to do the amniocentesis. Chorionic villus sampling, this should not be performed before 10 weeks of gestation. There is a possible association of oromandibular and the limb defects. Okay, we all know that during the embryogenesis, yes, by almost like the 8th week and all, you're getting all the limbs developed. By the 9th week, the spine develops. So you can imagine a fetus, the embryo over there, right? Whenever you're taking a sampling, just remember it is very close to those weeks of development. So just before 10 weeks, the oromandibular limb defects can happen. So you can correlate and remember, amniocentesis, you're taking out the fluid, the compartment gets collapsed, the baby's limbs, everything get inward turned. So talipoequinovarus, you can think like that. About the CVS, less than 10 weeks, it is all the embryogenesis which is happening, right? So it is going to be the oromandibular limb defects. So remember it that way. Less than 10 weeks when you perform a CVS, this is the complication that you can expect. Now, where possible, CVS should be performed from 11 weeks onwards. Like as we said, whenever it is possible, please perform after 11 weeks to reduce the risk of even technical challenges. Now, there are certain the tables which are being involved here. So what are the considerations when performing amniocentesis or chorionic villus sampling for a multiple pregnancy? This is very important. Okay. Till now, we have discussed regarding singleton pregnancy. What are we going to discuss now is about the multiple pregnancy. These recommendations are for multiple pregnancy. The women who is considering the amniocentesis or the CVS, they should receive a detailed counseling and pregnancy mapping by suitable trained healthcare professionals. So whoever is doing that, they should do it by a trained personnel only. And in multiple pregnancy, either amniocentesis or CVS, it should be performed by an operator who has the skills to perform selective termination of pregnancy if required. So amongst the multiple, if they want, like they want to do reduction, the fetal reduction, what we call it as selective termination, he should have that skill. Now, women with the multiple pregnancy, they should be informed that additional risk of pregnancy loss for twin pregnancy following CVS or amnio, when it is performed by a skilled operator, is around 1%. So just remember, singleton 0.5, multiple double that. It is 1%. It is easy to remember. So twins, it is you're going to double this percentage. Okay. Women with a multiple pregnancy and a confirmed diagnosis of an anomaly from amnio or CVS should be provided with the information and supported in a non-directive way, including referral to the specialist counseling. So it is their decision. Whenever any anomaly has been detected, it is their decision that what they want to do. They want to continue with that or they want to end the pregnancy. It is their decision. Now, a high level of expertise in the ultrasound scanning is essential for the operators to undertake the amnio or CVS. Yes, obviously, especially in case of multiple pregnancy, because the pregnancy needs to be correctly mapped, which is like what baby is where, like twin A, twin B, or sometimes triplets A, B, C. You have to map the pregnancy correctly so that even when you're doing prior to invasive testing, so each fetus is identified and sampled appropriately with the samples labeled correctly for the analysis also. Now, as some women and couples, they may choose a selective termination of their pregnancy based on the results of amnio or CVS. It is recommended that the operator who is skilled in doing this and the person who is skilled in performing selective termination based on the labeling, they should do the procedure. Yeah, just a minute. Okay. Now there was a study like Agarwal et al., and he reported that pregnancy loss following amniocentesis of 3.0% and estimated procedure-related risk pregnancy before 24 weeks. This he had reported as 1%. And it is also possible that the true amniocentesis, when it is done, that procedure-related risk of pregnancy loss in twins may be even less than 1% when they are doing it in a proper way. Okay. What is the role of third trimester amniocentesis? So the risk associated with the third trimester procedures, including the preterm labor, they are likely to be low. Now, risk of preterm labor before 34 weeks, it is usually like 3 to 4% in the limited studies. And women should be informed that there is a higher risk of cell culture failure also performed in the third trimester. And overall, there is a 10% risk of culture failure. This is the rationale for the third trimester amniocentesis, but risk is higher with the advancing gestation. You may not be able to find these cell cultures. That is what the study mentions. Okay, so this is the explanation. So third trimester amnio may be offered for the newly identified fetal structure and amnio like anomalies, which are newly detected in the third trimester, and a suspected fetal infection and the growth restriction if they are there. Now, there are two studies which conducted, and they reported that preterm labor before 37 weeks, the incidence was 4 to 8, and before 34 weeks, it was 3 to 4%. So after procedure, what was the risk of preterm delivery they have conducted? So almost close to, you can say 3 to 4, 4 to 8. Now, there is an increased risk of requiring more than one needle insertion, means a repeat procedure. Like 5% of these procedures may require another sample. And similarly, with the blood stain sample, it was seen in 5 to 10% also. So these are the common figures, like the 5% ones. Increased risk of culture failure following the third trimester amniocentesis, it was overall close to 9.7. You can just roll like round it off. So third trimester, so 3 and 3, you can see it is a third and the tri. So make it as 9.7% overall. Now, retrospective database analysis, it showed that amniocentesis procedure, when it was performed between 24 and 39, what happened? So they had studied for almost like 12 years and they had gone into the analysis. They had seen that there was a culture failure around 10%. And that increased with gestational age from 2.1 to slowly, like even 40.6 when it crossed beyond 36 to 40. So that all can vary. The percentages and other things can vary. But do not worry about these things. This has been newly introduced and just the points are being mentioned here. They will not ask you, they will not go into depth of these extra percentages. Okay. Now there is a chances of infection that can transfer from the mother to the baby when you're doing a needle procedure. So, screening result for the bloodborne virus or the viral load and the antigen test, these results should be reviewed whenever you're doing an invasive test. And it should be considered, and individualized risk of viral transmission also should be discussed in the cases where they are positive. Now, where screening tests for the bloodborne virus, they are not known, the test should be delayed until HIV status can be determined, because the risk for the mother to child transmission is higher for the women who are not highly, they are not on HRT therapies there. So highly active antiretroviral therapies and with a high viral load. So we don't know if they have the HIV positive or no. At least you can delay till that level. Now, the risk of mother to child transmission for HIV in the women on the heart treatment, the person who is already on treatment, this risk of transmission is going to be low. Now, antiretroviral treatment, it should be optimized for an undetectable viral loads prior to the amnio CVS. And you can say that the risk of mother to the child transmission regarding hepatitis B with the viral load less than 6.99, but it increases with the higher viral load, the transmission rate again increases. So you have to make sure about HIV, you have to make sure about hepatitis B, and there is no evidence of risk of mother to the child transmission of hepatitis C. This is based on the limited data which is available. C was not shown to get transmitted, B was depending on the viral load, and definitely HIV you have to discuss. Now, how much is the transmission rate? 2.3% whenever they are not on HRT. Now, where screening results for the bloodborne virus, they are not known, test should be delayed at least till results of HIV is there. And where the woman, she declines this test, what you should do? Take an informed consent. And this should include that there is a point, there is a risk of the mother to the child transmission during this procedure. You should mention that take an informed consent in the mother who declines HIV during the procedure when it is not done before. Okay, this can come as EMQs there. So just remember stepwise. First is you're asking them to do. Second, if you're refusing, then you're taking an informed consent plus you're mentioning about the risk of transmission. And there is also increased risk for the women with a higher load, high viral load, that it can be transferred. And the person who is not on the antiretroviral treatment. About the B and C, that we saw that B is low, but increased viral load, again, transmission could be there. Then there is no enough data about the C. So you can say that it is almost nil, you can see, because the data is very limited. Now, what does the old GTG was saying? So old GTG said, like, yes, it should be performed after 15, correct? But old GTG mentioned that amniocentesis before 14 weeks of this, it has a higher fetal loss rate. This was called as early amniocentesis during that time. And increased risk of fetal tallipus also and respiratory morbidity. And this was mentioned CVS, yes, it should not be performed before 10. So now what this new guideline has done? It has changed this 14-weeker. So between even 14 to 14 plus 6, they have included the CVS over there. Okay, so this point they have excluded from the old GTG. Now there are a few important points which were there in the old GTG which I have included here. The needle insertion, when you're doing the amniocentesis and the transabdominal CVS, it should be carried out under simultaneously ultrasound visualization by the good practitioner. Now, when you're doing a transplacental passage of that needle, when you're taking an amniocentesis sample, this should be avoided going through the placenta unless you see that this is the only safe way to enter. Okay. Otherwise, you are supposed to avoid the transplacental passage of the amniocentesis needle. This is important again. There are two points here. The maximum outer needle gauge. So it is 0.9 millimeter or it is a 20 gauge needle. Okay, don't get confused between 20 millimeter and 0.9 gauge. No, it is 0.9 millimeter. And it should be very, very thin and fine, right? So it should be less than 1 millimeter. So 0.9 millimeter and 20 gauge needle. This should be used to perform amniocentesis. Now, clinician, when they are doing the CVS techniques or this, they can use the local anesthesia for the transabdominal CVS procedure also. So these were few key points which were there in important in the old guidelines which I have included. Now, speaking about the headaches and how it occurs in the pregnancy and what are the different types of headaches. This is a very important topic in the part two. They keep on asking EMQs and minimum three or four questions are expected from this TOG article. It's a very simple TOG article, but very important one, and minimum three or four questions they are expected. So if you know this headache in and out, it becomes really easy to just solve these, and there are key points and the important words which you can remember. Now, most headache in the pregnancy, they are benign. Yes, we all agree. For example, 90% are just migraine, or they could be some tension type of headache. What are other common things? It could be eclampsia or the cortical venous thrombosis. So headache in pregnancy can be divided into a primary and a secondary headache. So we all know primary is going to be the migraine or the tension headache. Now, secondaries have so many reasons. One is a hypertension. Now, because hypertension, there could be some bleeding, subarachnoid bleeding. Some are drug related, because nifedipine, we all know, it goes and dilates the brain blood vessels over there, the cerebral blood vessels. So that dilatation causes throbbing kind of an headache. It is due to the drug related. Postdural tap. Now they undergo cesarean section. They are taking epidurals. So postdural tap, there is a leakage of the cerebrospinal fluid, and that can cause headache. Meningitis. This is very important again. Then cerebral venous thrombosis, anemia, caffeine withdrawal, idiopathic intracranial hypertension, stroke, AV malformation, pituitary tumors, then hormone sensitive tumors, bleeding into a tumor or cerebral metastasis. So these are going to be rare. So till this level, the stroke, then idiopathic intracranial or the upper parts, this can come as your EMQs or sometimes even SPA. Now, this is important, like 90% they are either the primary ones, the migraine and the tension one. Okay. Now, this is an important table which is given in the TOG article. What are the red flag features that you're supposed to know in potentially secondary headache also? Thunderclap. So a clap is something which is rapid, right? And what can happen in that rapid time? It is something hemorrhage. So whenever there is a thunderclap, just there is a rapid time to peak headache intensity. Within seconds to minutes, there is a very high intensity headache that the person gets. So that can happen when there is something like a bleed inside, right? Suddenly the vessel gives way and there is subarachnoid hemorrhage. So always remember in your exam, if you hear the word thunderclap or a rapid one and very severe intensity, this is going to be the subarachnoid hemorrhage there. Now, focal neurological symptoms. This could also happen, limb weakness or aura if they are there, or this another kind. Like there are only particular to one particular limb, they have some weakness. So it is something which is related to a focal neurological problem over there. Then something like a non-focal neurological problem, like non in this situation, the entire system could have been involved, like there is a cognitive disturbance, and this can happen in the central venous thrombosis. Now, there could be some change in the headache frequencies, and examination when you do neurological, it is either the limb muscle, the power, the weakness, everything you're seeing. So whenever you're doing an examination, you get to know whether there is a limb weakness or no. Now, whenever there is a change in the posture, because of posture, the cerebrospinal fluid can become high or low. That is related to the postdural puncture headache kind. When that's why post cesarean, sometimes we tell them not to sit for a long time, just lie down, relax, hydrate yourself, take coffee and other things. So these are going to bring down the incidences. Now, headache and awakening of the patient, something which is awakening, something which is disturbing. This could be with the migraine and some tension like raised intracranial pressure. Now, headache which is precipitated by physical exertion, okay, like a Valsalva maneuver. There are two possibilities. There is a subarachnoid hemorrhage or there is a raised intracranial pressure. That's why when we do Valsalva, it raises our ICP. Now, patient with the risk factor for the cerebral venous thrombosis, we have to explore that also. Now, patient may have jaw claudication along with visual disturbance. This is very important one and typical of giant cell arteritis. And so this is somewhere related to the jaw claudication or the visual disturbances. Now, whenever we know that there is fever or neck stiffness, we are considering meningitis or meningeal irritation. Now, new onset of headache sometimes can happen with an HIV infection or it could be some metastasis. So these are some red flag signs where we should get worried that this particular headache is there. Now, STRAT OG, it mentions few points and how to differentiate also. And this is adopted from one of the NICE guideline too. Now, headache, what is the location? How is the quality? How is the intensity? And what are the effect of activities on this particular headache? We should remember them. Tension is something like when you get tense, you put your hand on your head and you sit there, you try to press and you try. So you try to press your head, or sometimes what you do, you just put an entire band around your head and you tie your cloth or something, or you're completely holding your head with both the hands. So it is something which is encircling. The tension headache, most of the times, everything, it is going to be the bilateral. Okay? Pressing or tightening kind of a quality. It is non-pulsating. Fine? Because it is not related to the blood vessel here. It is mild or moderate in intensity, and it is not aggravated by the routine activities there. Okay? Now, what about migraine? It could be with or without aura. Now, in your exam, if they give you something like predisposing factors, like something flashes and vomiting, so these are all the with the aura symptoms. So if you're telling like migraine with aura, and if these are not there, don't mark it as simple migraine. You can tell it as migraine without aura. You have to mark that as your answer. Fine. They can give you all these options. Now, migraine could be unilateral or it could be bilateral. So till now we heard that tension headache is going to be bilateral. This could be both, like either uni or bilateral. Migraine, we all know that, excuse me, this is related to the vessel, right? So here it is going to be throbbing kind of an headache. It could be moderate or severe in intensity. And it is aggravated by causing avoidance of the or causes avoidance of the routine activities or daily living. So sometimes the routine things may disturb us, like loud music or something. We're just avoiding all these things. So we have to think about any precipitating factors for this particular migraine. Okay. Now, cluster headache. It is unilateral and often around the eye. So in this table, what do we see? Tension is going to be bilateral with the, both the hands we are sitting with catching hold of our head, right? Because of tension. Cluster means it has aggregated towards and it has collected towards one point, right? It has formed a cluster. Where does that cluster go? It goes around the eye. So it is going to be unilateral. It got clustered at one point, so it is going to be unilateral and it goes around the eye. And it could be of variable quality also, and severe or very severe intensity. The patient becomes restless and agitated because of this, because it is constantly aching at one point there. So the patient becomes restless and agitated. So I hope this table is going to be clear. I'm going to show you the picture also, how you are going to differentiate that. Now, other symptoms, like if there are there. Now, we all know migraine has so many trigger points. They are sensitive to light or sound. They can have nausea, vomiting. They can have all these aura symptoms. And symptoms can occur with or without headache. And these are fully reversible. They develop over at least 5 minutes and last for 5 to 60 minutes. And typically, the aura symptoms can have visual problems, sensory problems, speech disturbances could be there. Now, the cluster we saw, it is going to be at one point. It is surrounding the eye. So what happens in the eye? It is red and watery. Where should that go? It goes to the nose. So no nasal congestion or the runny nose it has because we have the nasolacrimal duct. So just remember that way. Swollen eyelid. And what about the forehead? Forehead and facial sweating can be there. Eye symptoms, constricted pupil. And the drooping eyelids. So everything is related to your eye and nose and forehead over there. These points are being clustered. Now, tension headache can, if the tension goes off, then yes, within 30 minutes we are free of that tension. So the headache also goes. Or if the tension persists, then the headache is going to be persistent. So remember, it can vary between 30 to even continuously, it could be there. So that factor which is causing that tension, if it is going to be there, then the headache will also persist. So remember that. Now, for the migraine, this can last for few hours to even few days. For example, it is going to be like this is 4 hours, or it could go to even 72 hours. Now, what about the cluster headache? It can last for few minutes, so 15 to 180 minutes, so almost close to 3 hours. So this can last for few minutes. The second one is the cluster. The longest one is going to... Okay, this figure is really important, and this will like solve all your headaches in pregnancy. So can you see this? This is so common. The sinuses, they are present, the frontal sinus, they are there, the ethmoidal sinus are there, the maxillary sinus are there. So this is very typical of sinusitis, which the patient comes with, right? Now, whenever there is tension, they are entirely they're catching hold, like a band-like thing they have tied up. So this is going to be the tension headache. Now, migraine, we saw that. Sometimes it could be unilateral or bilateral. So it is going to be one-sided headache typically in your question. Remember this. See the cluster. Now keep an I here and write a C. So this is going to be a C cluster around the eye. Remember this picture. The hormone-related headache could be like the changes, the PMS, whatever is happening hormone-related, it's going to be the global headache there. Hypertension typically in the occipital area. So this is the hypertension headache. So remember this figure. Now, I don't think any one of you will forget this. So tension is going to be entirely, it is a band which she has tied. Migraine is going to be the unilateral or sometimes rarely bilateral. Now, the cluster is going to be around one eye. So put it like a C around an eye. Okay, so this is going to be your cluster headache. Now, this picture, if you remember the basic questions, everything you'll be able to solve now. So we were speaking about migraine. It is more common in the childbearing age group. And the pregnancy, what happens is it leads to the reduction in the frequency and severity of attacks of migraine without aura. Remember this. Migraine, classically, it is unilateral. It is vascular related, so it is pulsating. It builds up over minutes to hours. And it is going to be moderate to severe intensity. And this is associated with the nausea, vomiting, or some sensitivity to the light or sensitivity to the sound. And sometimes it can make the person disabled and even aggravated by the routine physical activity also. Now, typically, this aura it is going to be fully reversible phenomena, and all these things, it involves the vision, sensation, motor power, balance, speech, and it's going to be the reversible phenomena. Now, symptoms can include which can precipitate the flickering of light, spots, some they can have some zigzag lines, tingling, numbness, some visual holes or scotoma, they are called as that could be there. And as we saw, it gets evolved over a few minutes and resolves within 60 minutes also. This can persist also for hours together. Migraine, we saw there are going to be two types. One is with aura and one is without aura. What do you do initially? You have to avoid. So we have been learning so many things that if you want something, it shouldn't happen. The first one is the prevention, right? So avoidance of the precipitant is very important. Second thing, when it happens, take good rest. Keep yourself well hydrated, eat regular meals, and relax. This headache sometimes it subsides by its own without requiring any treatment. The basic treatment what we can start with is a paracetamol, and if the patient has vomiting, give the antiemetics. There are sumatriptans. These are considered even safe in the pregnancy. And some NSAIDs, which can be given in the initial part of pregnancy. You cannot give beyond 28 weeks. So in the initial part, it can be given. Prophylactically, what you can do, propranolol for 10 to 40 milligrams, it can be started 3 times a day. If they have like 3 to 4 headaches and they are not responsive to the simple analgesics, remember this is going to be the stepwise approach for your EMQ. First important thing is avoidance of all the trigger events. Then you're going to give the rest, hydration, adequate regular meals, and the relaxation techniques and all. The third, you're starting with the drugs. In that, preferred one is paracetamol, give antiemetics, start triptans, NSAIDs, and propranolol. So go it in this way. The last one is going to be the amitriptyline. So this can be given in the lowest possible effective dose, like 25 to 50 milligram at night. So remember the stepwise approach for your EMQs. This is a very important chart or the table that I can see. It comes in your exam. So, how do we remember this? When the person has migraine, this person has some risk. So, what are those risks? The person can develop preeclampsia. Okay, it is PE. Remember, there are two letters, PE and preeclampsia. So, this is going to be twofold risk. The person who has migraine, he or she, like she has twofold risk of developing preeclampsia. Now, what about our heart? Our heart has four chambers. So the risk of having the myocardial infarction, there is a fourfold increased risk when the person is having migraine. So she has a fourfold increased risk of having the condition of myocardial infarction. So remember, heart has four chambers and MI is going to be fourfold. What about stroke? Stroke is your S and 17 is your S. So stroke is 17-fold increased. Remember this. So what are the risks which are associated with migraine? One is the preeclampsia, PE, twofold. MI is your heart related, so four chambers and fourfold. S is for stroke and S is for 17, so that is going to be 17-fold. Okay, I hope you're not going to forget this now. What about the postural puncture headache or the spinal headache that the person could have? This is very important. Like on day-to-day basis, I think all of us must have encountered with our patients whenever, especially the post cesarean section and all. Now, the puncture of this dura. Okay, so this can happen in how many percentage of epidurals? This is very important. So, just as a general thing, 0.5 to 2.5%. If accidentally the dural puncture occurs with an epidural needle, it is a bigger needle, right? So, there is a 70 to 80% chance that postdural puncture headache will occur. So, there are five patients sitting there, and all five patients had an epidural. In that, these five patients had accidental dural puncture when you are giving epidural for them, all the five. Four of them developed headache. Now, is it easy to remember that five people are sitting, all five had epidural, all five got punctured, four of them developed headache, one did not. So, 70 to 80% chance of having a postdural puncture headache. Now, the headache is usually in the frontooccipital region and it radiates to the neck. This is typically how the cerebrospinal fluid goes, right? The frontooccipital neck, everything. And it is characteristically worsening on position. So, on standing, it is going to get worsened. And typically, it develops 24 to 48 hours post puncture. We all know this. Just prior, we will be thinking, okay, now she's fit and fine. Probably like day three and all, she'll be able to go home or something, and she starts complaining of headache. So, this scenario we can remember between 1 to 2 days post puncture, they complain of all this typical headache. We'll be all ready that, okay, this person is doing really well. We can discharge her home, and then she complains of headache. Now, conservative management includes. Yes, as we all know, good hydration, simple analgesics. So we give them all like by the mouth, then the IV fluids, then simple analgesics can be given. Untreated, the headache typically lasts for 7 to 10 days. And sometimes even the postpartum period, the entire 6 weeks it could last. So if you're not going to treat, tell her, if I give you medicine, you'll get better. If I don't give you medicine, probably 1 week you will have this headache. 1 week to 10 days you will have this headache. And sometimes the entire your postpartum period of the initial 6 weeks, you're going to have this. So remember that as a scenario, right? So what did we learn? Puncture of the dura. This is going to be 0.5 to 2.5%. This is the first point what we learned. Now there were five people sitting there and five people underwent the epidural and all of five of them had a dural puncture. Four of them developed the headache. So it is going to be your 80%, right? 70 to 80% chance of a postdural puncture headache when it was punctured with an epidural needle. Now this patient was about to go home. Within 1 or 2 days, she started developing headache. So the occurrence, the typically develops 24 to 48 hours after the post puncture. You gave her conservative measures. You told her, don't stand, just lie down and take some fluids, keep yourself hydrated, and you also can take some like painkillers. Then she said, no, I don't want to take doctor. Then how long it's going to last? Then you said, if you're not going to take anything, probably 7 or 10 days it's going to last, or even your 6 weeks of your postpartum. So she says, like, okay, let me take some medicine. Now, things are not working well. You have to go one step ahead. So, involve your anesthetist colleague. So, what do they do? Epidural blood patch. This is one procedure where the blood is going to be placed inside with the help of this epidural. They're going to place that blood patch over there. So, this is effective in 60 to 90%. It has a cure rate. So the blood, when we are doing this, is the highest cure rate that is found. So when other measures are not working, the epidural blood patch is going to be applied, and this cures for almost 60 to 90%. This comes as a recall, so please do remember. What is posterior reversible encephalopathy or the PRESS? So this also we see sometimes in our preeclampsia patients and all, we see it. So it is something like clinical and neuroradiological entity. Because there is swollen structures. So the person has headache, vomiting, visual disturbance, seizures, altered mental state, and what do you see on the imaging studies? There is edema of the posterior circulation of the brain. So that is why it is called posterior. It is reversible condition. That's why it is called as posterior reversible encephalopathy. Now, this is associated with some immunosuppressive drugs. or it could be some sepsis, nephrotic conditions, SLEs, and other things also. Now, management usually follows how we do the lines of the preeclampsia. So, in preeclampsia, also, what we do, the diagnostic criteria for headache, which is attributable to preeclampsia, we see that any woman in which she's pregnant and she gets a headache, she should see that all these criteria are being fulfilled or no. Preeclampsia or eclampsia has already been diagnosed for her, and at least two of them, like for example, the headache which has developed in the temporal relation to the onset of the preeclampsia or eclampsia. So, along with these onset only, she has started developing headache. It has significantly worsened along with the worsening of the preeclampsia or eclampsia and or improved or resolved. Now, headache has at least two of the following these characters. What are they? So, bilateral, pulsating. We know because preeclampsia is something related to vessel. So, bilateral, pulsating, and it is aggravated by the physical activity. And this usually does not get better with the other diagnosis which are holding true. There is something called as reversible cerebral vasoconstriction syndrome. So the cerebrovascular disease or this, it could be somewhere the many arteries would be there. So it is a multifocal arterial constriction and dilatation which is happening. And this is going to be reversible. So there is a significant association with the postpartum period. They have found this. And recurrent, sudden, severe. So this is going to be coming again and again. And this is going to be a sudden onset and severe. Over 1 to 3 weeks, it can happen. So whenever you get a severe headache, definitely nausea, vomiting, photophobia, confusion, all these things can come. And there is a demonstrable, you can see that the arterial beading, whenever you're doing the cerebral angiography, you get the beading kind of pattern there. So that can be related to the constriction of these vessels. So it makes it appear in a beaded thing, like how the beads of string will be there, right? I mean, the string of beads will be there, right? So there, the beads are there and the constricted areas are there, then the beads again, they appear. So there are different areas where the arterial constrictions and dilatations are there. So it is kind of a beaded appearance that you're going to get on the imaging studies, like cerebral angiographies. And this shows like usual resolution within 1 to 3 months. Now there is a differentiation between the postpartum thunderclap headache, which is often made after subarachnoid hemorrhage. This has been excluded, but headaches can reoccur. Okay, so this is one of your differential diagnosis. Now, because there is arterial vasospasm, you have to release that. So your calcium channel blockers are going to act there. And high dose corticosteroids or magnesium sulfate. We know that majority where the answer is going to be like steroids and even magnesium sulfate. What about the cerebral venous thrombosis? This can happen in 1 in 2,500 or 1 in 10,000 deliveries. And pregnancy, it's a risk factor because it itself is a prothrombotic state. Plus, there are added factors. We are very well versed. I think most of you must have already read about the venous thromboembolism guidelines and also pregnancy itself is a prothrombotic risk factor. And there are so many things associated: cesarean section, vomiting, anemia, dehydrations, infections, and they could all these things are going to be putting you at risk. Now, greatest risk is going to be between the third trimesters and the initial postpartum phase. So this is going to be a crucial time for a mother. We have to take care of her. Most commonly, which sinus is affected? It is your sagittal sinus. And with the extension into the cortical veins could be there. Now, headache can happen. This is the most common presenting symptoms. Along with that, there is a papillary edema, some deficits, confusion, and cranial nerves involvement could be there, especially diplopia and sixth nerve involvement could be there. Psychosis can happen. So, how do we diagnose this condition? There are two ways. We all know that it is something related to the vein. So, computed tomography, this one CT scan, is widely used as initial imaging tool. Remember, it is an initial imaging tool in the patients who present with headache or focal neurological signs. But plain CT is insensitive for CVT because it is something like venous related, right? And it shows abnormality only in 30%. So you cannot rely on CT here. But it is usually when a person has headache, we do get like CT brain and see like what is the problem. Because it is a vein related problem, the sensitive one, the most important imaging modality of choice is going to be your MR venography. In exam, if they tell you CVT and what is one investigation which you want to offer, please pick the magnetic resonance imaging, that is your MR venogram or venography. This has to be your answer. Now, because it is a thrombus, we know the treatment is going to be anticoagulation, and it requires for a long time, maybe 6 months too. Now, because in this pregnancy she had the CVT, or in this post-delivery she had the CVT, next pregnancy also she becomes a risk factor. Probably you have to reassess her and calculate the risk factor, and you may have to start even from the time the pregnancy is confirmed also. Now, follow up with the MR venography at 3 to 6 months after the diagnosis. This is also suggested, like it shows that recanalization, how it occurs. So that also can be done. Okay, there are certain key points, like whenever you are thinking about imaging of the head in the pregnancy. So accepted background cumulative dose, you see that it's a 50 microcurie. Then fetal exposure can happen to CT scan. It is less than 0.005, and MRI should be avoided in the first trimester because it shows hyperthermia and there's an acoustic noise. But MRI remains preferable to any studies using the ionizing radiations. So MRI preferably in the first trimester you try to avoid. What about contrast media? So anything which is iodine based, it should be avoided there. So if iodinated contrast media are used, the neonatal thyroid function should be checked later when the baby is born. Gadolinium-based contrast, these appear to be safe in pregnancy. Remember this. And lactating women who receive the iodinated contrast or the gadolinium contrast, they can continue to breastfeed without interruption. Okay, these are few points about the radiation or about the imaging of the head in pregnancy. Okay, let me ask you quickly a few questions about your headache and the amniocentesis or other things and all. So, amniocentesis, anybody can tell which gauge needle was used? So, just write down in the chat box quickly. I'm not asking about millimeter here, I'm asking about the gauge. 20, perfect. Very good. 20, very good. And what is the risk of CVS and the amniocentesis, the loss with when it is performed with a person who is adequately trained? 0.5%. Very good, Kia. Very good. So all of you are attentively are listening to this. So let me quickly show some questions here. The percentage of response of postdural puncture headache to the blood patch. A, B, C, D, E. Blood patch D, very good, very good. This is D, it is 60 to 90%. It's not more than 90, it is 60 to 90%. Very good. This is an EMQ, so let us see all these scenarios. So, I'll be getting back to these options. So, what do we have? We have a cluster headache, there's an exertional, very good. There's a migraine with aura, without aura, subdural hematomas, arachnoid hemorrhage, and the cerebral venous thrombosis, tension headache, thunderclap. Okay, so these are, you have some background knowledge now. You have to find out your answer. Now, pregnant or postpartum, she's there. She was awakened by a headache that is described as her worst headache ever, and there is associated some neck stiffness also. So, what is going to be your worst headache ever? Very good, Mona. So this is going to be your F, right? The worst headache ever is going to be your subarachnoid hemorrhage, thunderclap. Very good. So this is all your key points that you should know. Now, headache that is preceded by the flashes, black spots in front of the eye. So they are getting flashes. Oh, sorry, they are getting flashes. See, very good. So these are your the aura symptoms that the person is having, right? So flashes, black spots, all these are going to be your aura. So there can be options like here it is given migraine with aura, migraine without aura. A simple migraine also could have been given. So in your answer, if the patient has aura, you're going to pick it as migraine with aura. In your answer, if the patient does not have aura and you're suspecting it to be migraine, then please choose the answer as migraine without aura. Right? Don't take it as only migraine because you tell that there is no aura, right? So you have to go for migraine without aura in that condition. Please do remember. Well done, all of you. Okay. Now, pregnant, she came complaining of throbbing, band-like headache, and that lasts for 60 minutes, and there was no nausea, vomiting, nothing, and it was not aggravated by physical activity. It is a band-like headache. Very good. So without looking at the option, you all know that it is going to be your tension headache, right? So your band-like headache is going to be tension. Very good. Now, a woman, she presented in the late pregnancy at 35 weeks, pregnancy, third trimester. Remember, complaining of severe headache, nausea, stiffness, confusion, visual problems, blood pressure is 160, 90. MRI is done and it shows a defect while it was filling posteriorly. There is a filling defect. So something is blocking that vein, right? What could be blocking here? Very good, Mona. So, Shasta, very good, dear. So this is something which is blocking, then that is going to be your cerebral venous thrombosis, right? Well done. Okay, so this was regarding the new guideline, the amniocentesis. It's a very small, crisp guideline. Not much points will come from them, but it was being under review for quite a long time, and then it has appeared. So it's important that you know the changes and what are the differences. At the same time, I have also uploaded key points about what the differences are there between the old guideline that we should remember. And now we are starting the crash course. So this is going to start from 20th of January. So all the important talks and guidelines, the recent ones are going to be covered. And we do have some like question pools or mock tests in the end of your course. And we create a small Telegram group where a lot of charts and images and the talk articles, the important boxes, everything they get shared. And we do the live sessions. We record them. We give the access to them. And we are building upon a good course library so that all the crisp materials, they are put in together. This is going to be targeting the January exam. It's going to be only for the 6 weeks. So we have initially introduced this at 23,600 INR, but we have brought down for this particular 24 hours, I'm getting it down to 17,700 INR. So whoever are interested, please do DM. And this I'm going to keep this the charges valid till tomorrow night, 10 p.m. So 24 hours from now. Okay. So all the best. Keep practicing. Any doubts you have, just put in over there and do give a feedback about how the session was. Okay. All the best, dears. Keep studying. Take care. Good night. Lovely having you all. Thank you so much.